The Arts Now, they're one of the most influential bands of their generation, and through multiple lineups, Massive Attack have somehow managed to keep on making music. Their debut album, Blue Lines, routinely makes critics' lists as the 1990s most important album. Now, the two core members, Robert Del Naya and Grant Marshall, have got back together again to play concerts for Palestinian refugees. I caught up with Robert for a rare interview at the Brixton Academy, hearing about his causes and the band's planned new album.
We've been to Israel twice and played in Israel when there was less trouble on the ground. And we got to see the place personally. We got to sort of go to Bethlehem, Jerusalem, spent time in Tel Aviv, obviously. And we didn't get a chance to, we feel, sort of like address the sort of our music and sort of communicate with the Palestinians. And as much as we did with the Israelis, we've been there twice and we tried to set up concerts which were very hard to try and organise, you know, for sort of political and insurance reasons, which we found frustrating. 2 years later, we went to Beirut and went to Baalbek and did a concert there on the border of Syria and Lebanon. And again, we met a lot of different people and we still felt it'd be great to be able to do something to address, you know, the Palestinian issue, bring highlight what we feel is probably a slight misbalance in terms of what you can and can't do within the region musically and creatively. We felt we didn't have a chance to go there and communicate what we do. And after meeting Karma through the Hoping Foundation, it meant indirectly we could actually sort of do something musically, creatively or culturally to communicate.
To communicate and also to raise money.
Exactly.
Karma, the Hoping Foundation, you're working with Palestinian refugees in Jordan, Syria and in the territories as well, yeah?
Yes. And Gaza and the West Bank and Lebanon, yes, exactly. And actually we've also supported some of the Palestinian refugees on the border in Iraq now and Syria who are now in tents, who have fled from Baghdad. But we deal exclusively with refugee children and their families.
And Robert, are you able yourself to meet or go to see the refugees?
Plan to take a trip actually with Karma later on this year, which would be really interesting. So I think most of our information and our decisions we make come from experience from travelling and meeting people and going places. You know, for us as a band, being in a fortunate position to do that, it informs what we think about our position in the world and politically and sort of musically, really.
What do you think about the decision of European Union, Americans, I mean, just about everyone, to not to deal with the Hamas government because they won't accept the right of Israel to exist? Do you see that as legitimate?
I think it's important to sort of try and depoliticize it, and I think working with Karma and the Hoping, it's, we're trying to take it away from politics and also talk about people, about human rights, about freedom, about basic justice, about equality. And I think in music it's an issue we all talk about in terms of almost ideologically, but I tend to not try and get too. I think it's a part of the story that has been kind of, I feel, sort of pretty much controlled and hijacked by the media in a sense. If you do try and have an opinion on the issue, it's been made very polar.
But as you say, you've played in Israel, so this is not in any sense an anti-Israeli expression by a Massive Attack, no?
Not at all. It's never has been. It's not about saying we're pro or con anything. We're all about sort of peace and about, I think, you know, communication, about justice, equality. I think, you know, it's frustrating that we feel a lot of people feel they're not able to talk about it because it's too hot a subject, and I think that creates the problems, that creates frustration.
I read in The Guardian they said you're the most politicised band, certainly in the UK. How do you feel about that?
I think it's a burden, that, as a statement, yeah. I don't feel absolutely comfortable with that. I don't think we're any more political than a lot of the bands we've met, you know, on our travels, you know, in America and the UK and Europe. I think we've just probably been sort of provoked by frustration into sort of saying things or being there at a certain time. I find the most frustrating thing is that people respond well to crises, you know, and it's great. We've always worked with the Red Cross and more recently the Red Crescent and Greenpeace and other organisations like Amnesty International that deal with problems after they've happened. But I find it frustrating that people are more reluctant, I guess, to deal with things that are about to happen. And obviously,
when you deal with a situation with a potential war or a potential invasion and the obvious violence and the fallout from that, people don't like to take sides. They don't like to put their hands up and say, wait a minute. And I think it's great being there at the end when you donate to sort of like form relief in a charitable sense. But I find that frustrating when people don't want to be there at the beginning and try and take preventative action of some sort.
She's doing so much harm, doing so much damage, but you don't want to get involved. You tell her she can manage.
I mean, obviously, there is a direct effect in as much as money goes to the causes you support. Do you actually think you make much difference to the opinions of your fans, the people who come to concerts like this?
Well, I mean, we did the two shows we did this week. I sensed a definite seriousness about the crowd, and I don't think it's because they weren't enjoying the music. It's just I felt there was a definite sense that we, as well as, you know, playing music and communicating that, we had to. It was a seriousness. People wanted to engage, I think, and we were projecting information from the screens, transmitting ideas, and that form of communication. I think people come away with something, and I think it is really sort of productive, definitely. I think then you see the reaction on the web and people start talking about it and so forth and so on. And I think, like most things, it happens very slowly in a small way with individuals, and people I met after the show were very interested in the Hoping Foundation and didn't know a lot of the statistics that were sort of a part of the whole issue.
Judging from the sound check we were hearing, you've drawn inspiration too from Middle Eastern music.
Definitely, you know, I think that's again, being fortunate enough to travel, we've sampled and stolen the best of everything we've had a chance to get our hands on, you know, around the world, and it's, you know, it's been really great, and that's a lucky thing we've been able to do, you know, and being able to represent it in a new collage, send it back the other way, it's really exciting, you know.
I mean, you've been through many changes in lineup, different teams working on different albums. I mean, in 2007, who or what is Massive Attack now, do you think?
As a project, it's still myself and Mr. Marshall, the tall chap, and we're still working with Horace Andy, who's ever-present, Elizabeth Fraser, Damon Auburn's done a couple of things with us, and a few other people that you might not have heard of, you know, local people in Bristol, etc. And, you know, we're still trying to work out what shape the record's trying to make at the moment. Still sort of a bit ambiguous, but...
And the new one's going to be called Weather Underground or not?
That's a mischievous title.
Well, it won't be, will it?
I'm not sure, actually. Because the problem is I sort of came out with that idea, you know, in America, and I didn't really confer with my partner, and he was like, okay, so you're deciding what the record's going to be called now, are you? I said, well, actually, maybe we should talk about it, you know, in a more democratic fashion. So we'll debate that later, I think.
And as a project, what sort of project is that now? Musically, what is it?
What, the new record?
Yeah.
Well, we're trying to do something in a sort of gothic soul direction, where we're trying to use and kind of work on the things we were about through all the sort of all our history, in a way, I guess. You know, from sort of the soul reggae roots of our sort of like youth, and also the sort of like more punk new wave thing. If we can try and work that alchemy, that'd be great. If it doesn't work, it'd be a disaster, you know.
And I read, I don't know quite how this works, you and Mr. Marshall actually work separately. Is that how it works?
We've crossed a few bridges recently, and we're working together in the same studio, which is interesting. I mean, after 18 years with someone, that relationship, it always is a little bit sort of, you know, two blokes in the same room. You know what it's like.
Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.